In medicine, the term evidence-based causes more arguments than you might expect, and that's quite apart from the recent political controversy over why certain words were avoided in CDC budget documents. The arguments don't divide along predictable partisan lines either. Evidence-based medicine is the topic of this week's Healthcare Triage. The mission of evidence-based medicine is surprisingly recent. Before its arrival, much of medicine was based on clinical experience. Doctors tried to figure out what worked by trial and error, and they passed their knowledge along to those who trained under them. Many were first introduced to evidence-based medicine through David Sackett's handbook, first published in 1997. The book taught me how to use test characteristics like sensitivity and specificity to interpret medical tests. It taught me how to understand absolute risk versus relative risk. It taught me the proper way to use statistics in diagnosis and treatment and in weighing benefits and harms, and hopefully I've used it to teach all of you something about all of that over the years. It also firmly established in my mind the importance of randomized controlled trials and the great potential for meta-analyses, which group individual trials for greater impact. This influence is apparent in what we do here at Healthcare Triage. But evidence-based medicine is often described quite differently. Many of its supporters say that using evidence-based medicine can address the problems of cost, quality, and access that bedevil the healthcare system. If we all agree upon best practices based on data and research, we can reduce unnecessary care, save money, and push people into pathways to yield better results. Critics of evidence-based medicine, many of them from within the practice of medicine, point to weak evidence behind many guidelines. Some believe that medicine is more of an art than a science, and that limiting the practice to a cookbook approach removes focus from the individual patient. Some of these critics, as well as many of you who watch these videos, worry that guidelines line the pockets of pharmaceutical companies and radiologists by demanding more drugs and more scans. Others worry that evidence-based medicine makes it harder to get insurance companies to pay for needed care. Insurance companies worry that evidence-based recommendations put them on the hook for treatment with minimal proven value. Everyone's a bit right here, and everyone's a bit wrong. This battle is not new. It's been going on for some time. It's the old guard versus the new. It's the patient versus the system. It's freedom versus rationing. It's even the individual physician versus the proclamations of the specialized elite. The benefits of evidence-based medicine, when properly applied, are obvious. We can use test characteristics and results to make better diagnoses. We can use evidence from treatments to help people make better choices once diagnoses are made. We can devise research to give us the information we're lacking to improve lives. And when we have enough studies available, we can look at them together to make widespread recommendations with more confidence than we'd otherwise be able. When evidence-based medicine is not properly applied, though, it not only undermines its reasons for existence, but it also can lead to harm. Guidelines, and there are many, are often promoted as evidence-based, even though they rely on evidence unsuited to its application. Sometimes these guidelines are used by vested interests to advance an agenda or control providers. Further, too often we treat all evidence as if it's equivalent. I've lost track of the number of times I've been told, even by many of you, that research proves I'm wrong. All research is not the same. A hierarchy of quality exists, and we have to be sure not to overreach. There's a difference between statistical significance and clinical significance. Get a large enough cohort together, and you will achieve the former. That by itself does not ensure that the results achieve clinical significance and should alter clinical practice. Finally, we have to recognize that even when good studies are done with clinically significant results, we shouldn't over-extrapolate the findings. Just because something worked in a particular population doesn't mean we should do the same things to another group and say that we have evidence for it. Years ago, Trisha Greenhall and colleagues wrote an article in the BMJ citing evidence-based medicine as a movement in crisis. It argued that we've moved too much from focusing on disease to risk. This point, more than any other, highlights the problem evidence-based medicine seems to have in the public sphere. Too many articles, studies, and announcements are quick to point out that something or other has been proved to be dangerous to our health, without a good explanation of the magnitude of that risk or what we might reasonably do about it. Big data, gene sequencing, artificial intelligence, all of these may provide us with lots of information on how we might be at risk for various diseases. What we lack is knowledge about what to do with what we might learn. If evidence-based medicine is to live up to its potential, it seems the focus should be on that side of the equation as well, instead of taking best guesses and calling them evidence-based. That, probably more than anything else, has made the term so widely mistrusted. We love to make videos about things that sometimes YouTube doesn't like to sell to advertisers. And we're fine with that because what we do is more important than the money we might make. That said, any support you can give us to help keep the show going helps to make it bigger and better. And one good way to do that is through a subscription service called Patreon.com. You can go to patreon.com/healthcaretriage and give as little as $1 a month to help the show keep going. If you don't, that's fine. We're gonna keep on making it anyway. We'd also appreciate if you subscribe to the show, maybe like the video if you liked it. That'd be great too. We'd especially like to thank our Surgeon Admiral Sam and our research associates Joe Sevitz and Carlos Iergo. We also have some great merch you might like. We have mugs and posters and lunch boxes and other stuff, and you can check it all out at hctmerch.com. I also have my book, it's still available anywhere books are sold, The Bad Food Bible. I'd really appreciate it if you pick up a copy.